Good morning, everybody. Boker Tov. We are here at Kollel Ahavat Israel. Today we have a special class about this week's parasha, Parashat Vayetzeh. So Baruch Hashem, today we are here in Kollel Ahavat Israel in San Diego. Hayom anachnu nase Parashat Vayetzeh. Yaakov Avinu is right now 63 years old. And he's about to leave his family, his parents. And we see something amazing. Yaakov Avinu, the Torah says, Vayetze Yaakov miBe'er Sheva, Vayelech Charana. Yaakov is living in Be'er Sheva, and is going to a place that named Charana. As we know, the place Charana is really Haran, but the Torah here changed the name and add the letter He to it. You know, Haran. Charana, meaning that Hashem is walking with him. He is the letter of Hashem, as we know, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu goes with him. So Be'ezat Hashem, this year will be L'Refuah Shelema of Noah Bat Ortal, קרן בת אליזה, שולמית בת ציפורה, אפרים בן דבורה, עדי בן נעמה, בעזרת השם. הקדוש ברוך הוא ירפא אותם, אין נרפן עליהם. So it says, as we say, ויצא יעקב מבאר שבע וילך חרנה. So first and foremost, ויצא יעקב מבאר שבע. As we know, יעקב אבינו now is really in a very dangerous peculiar spot, as Esav, his brother, wants to kill him. And Yaakov is leaving, and he goes out, 63 years old, and all of a sudden Torah says, "Vayevga b'makom vayelen sham kiva hashemesh." You know, it says "Vayevga b'makom." Every time the Torah says "makom," "makom" means a place, but it's also a name for Yerushalayim, and a name for Hashem. You know, there are 70 names to Yerushalayim, to Jerusalem. And Hashem has many, many names. Some say, the Zohar rabbis say something amazing. They say that the entire Torah, imagine, there is in the Torah, not imagine, for sure, 304,805 letters. This is all the name of Hashem. Of course, we know the name of Hashem as the Yud Hei Vav Hei, and Adonut, and Hashem, and Elohim, and Elohim. There are many names. But here it says, Vayevga b'makom vayelen sham kiva shemesh. It says that HaKadosh Baruch Hu did a miracle for Yaakov. Yaakov Avinu, when he left, the Gemara will tell us that he actually skipped Jerusalem. He skipped Jerusalem, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu, almost, you know, the Zohar said that he transferred Yaakov into Har Moriah, into what we call Temple Mount, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu made him stay there for the night. The Torah says, Kiva HaShemesh, meaning HaKadosh Baruch Hu turned off the sun. Kiva, from Hebrew, Lechabot, to turn off. The Gemara will teach us in the Zohar that actually HaKadosh Baruch Hu made the sun go down and in 2 hours and it become dark. And it says that Yaakov Avinu took stones from the place, from Hamakom, Vayasem Roshota Vayishkav Bamakom Ahu. Yaakov Avinu, you know, took 12 stones. The Gemara will teach us that those 12 stones will be the same stones that were used in the past, that were used from all the way from Adam Arishon, from Adam that did the sacrifice there. Cain and Hevel did a sacrifice there. We know Noah did a sacrifice there. And then Abraham did a sacrifice. The Akedah, you know, was there. Yaakov now take those 12 stones, and he says, the Torah, that he puts them around his head, meaning he did not really care for his physical world. He cared about his spirituality. You know, when Hashem created the world, we know that Hashem in the Torah says, Bereshit bara Elohim et ha-shamayim ve-et ha-aretz. Shamayim is the heavens, Eretz is the, what we call, you know, our world, the earth. Yaakov Avinu never cared for the earthly matters. As we know, Yaakov Avinu was tam, Yoshev Ohalim. He was always residing in the tents of God. You know, Ohalim in Hebrew is also Elohim. When Tam is Torah and Mitzvot. And now that Esav, you know, want to kill him, Yaakov Avinu is heading out. Of course, he's going to a place named Haran, but the Torah changes to Harana, meaning that it'll be Hashem with him, the letter Hey added, like, you know, Vayered Avraham Mitzrayma, like when Avraham went to Egypt, the word Mitzrayim added the letter Hey. Every time the Torah add the letter Hey, meaning that Hashem is with you there. So here this says that HaKadosh Baruch Hu turned off the sun and Yaakov gathered 12 stones. And he put them around his head, you know, meaning to protect his head. He didn't really care for his physical body, so to speak. And he says, וַיַּחֲלֹם וְהִנֵּה סֻלָּם מֻצָב אַרְצָה וְרֹשׁוֹ מַגִּיעַ שָׁמַיִמָה וְהִנֵּה מַלְאָכֵי אֱלֹהִים עֹלִים וְיוֹרְדִים בּוֹ. All of a sudden, Yaakov has a dream, and the dream is a very odd one. You know, he said that there is the ladder, meaning, you know, the sulam, it's standing on the ground, and the angel going up and coming down. Usually, first and foremost, angels do not need a ladder to climb. Angels fly. They don't really need any help with any ladder or any elevator or escalator or steps. You know, angels, there is 10 kinds of angels, all kinds. You know, there are some angels that have 6 wings. Some of them are 4, some of them are 2. Some of them, you know, looks like, you know, Malachi HaSharet, those are all the angels that we do mitzvot. Each mitzvah become an angel. So there is an angel of a blessing, an angel of bracha. When you hold a fruit and you say a bracha on the fruit, you actually create an angel for yourself. So it says here that the angel going up, from the ground up into this heavenly, you know, ladder, and calm down angels from the heavenly ladders. So, you know, Yaakov Avinu had malachim, you know, as we know, you know, Yaakov Avinu has angels with him all the time. As we know, in the book of Tehillim, you know, in the book of Psalms, it says, "Malachav yitzave lecha lishmorcha bechol derechecha." And Hashem will send angels to watch you all over, wherever you are, you know, Bechol derechecha, everywhere you walk. You know, we have many angels surrounding us. Many of us don't really grasp the amazing reality where we are saved constantly. You know, even just going on the freeway, driving, you know, across the country or across the city or whatever the case, there's thousands and thousands of cars. And Baruch Hashem, there is rarely accident in comparison to the amount of cars. You know, just to go from here to LA, for an example, you can encounter 500,000 cars. Think about it for a second. And you go to Los Angeles from San Diego, come back, and, you know, one car moves aside, 50 cars get into a major accident, especially driving at 70, 80 miles an hour. Those are angels protecting us all the time. We're waking up in the morning, angel with us. We're going to sleep, angel with us. Every mitzvah we do, we create an angel. And chas v'chalila, we also create an angel for avera, for not a good deed that we're doing. So Yaakov Avinu, he says, you know, that he sees in his dream that the angel going up and yordim bo and coming down. So there is a many, many, you know, teaching by our sages saying that first and foremost, he sees the angels of Yaakov going up, and then he sees the angel of Esav coming down. And he was worried, he was terrified. Later on we'll say, Man nora ha-makom hazeh, how, you know, scary this place is. You know, we learn something amazing also. You know, Yaakov Avinu, when he sees this angel going up and down, he has very much, you know, the understanding that something is very, very odd happening here. So it says that when every time Yaakov Avinu sees the angels going up, his good angels, and the bad angels coming down, he was actually notified of the 4 destructions that the people of Israel will incur with the galuyot, you know, the exile. So it was, of course, we know the first one was the Egypt, and then there was the Babylonian, then there was the Persian, then there were the Greeks, then there were the Romans. We are right now in the last exile, the exile of Christianity, Edom, the Edomites, the exile of Esav. So Yaakov Avinu, he says, "V'hineh Adonai nitzav alav." He sees Hashem standing above him, "V'yomer, I am God now speaking in a dream to Yaakov Avinu. You know, just so you know, Hashem only spoke to Moshe face to face. All the other prophets, Hashem came to them and spoke to them through dreams. In Avraham Avinu, for an example, he spoke through the tree, Alon Mamre, you know, the oak tree. And many times, Sarah was the only one as a female. There was 48 male prophets and 7 female prophets. And Hashem spoke to Sarah directly. You know, Sarah is Hashem, as we know, the angel of Hashem. But when he came to here, Hashem speaks to Yaakov through the dream, and he says to him, I am the God of your father, Avraham, and the God of Yitzchak. Something is very odd here. First and foremost, we know Avraham was not the father of Yaakov. He was the grandfather of Yaakov. The father of Yaakov was Yitzchak. So what was Hashem saying here? You know, Hashem is basically revealing to Yaakov, just, you know, I want you to not worry about the blessings that you received from Yitzchak. Even though you think you received them because originally Esav was supposed to get them, no. I want you to know that the blessings that I blessed Avraham is the same blessing that I blessed Yitzchak, is the same blessing that I will bless you. Basically, the continuation of blessing will come from Avraham through Yitzchak, through Yaakov. You know, the forefathers are the only 3 that could bless the entire world. You know, it says, whoever blesses you will be blessed, whoever curses you will be cursed. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu revealed to Yaakov here in a dream that first and foremost, you know, the blessings that I gave Avraham, even though he was really your grandfather, is the same as I gave to your father, Yitzchak, and you will get the same kind of blessing. It says, the land that you sleep upon it, lecha etnena lezarcha. You know, the Midrash Tanhuma says that HaKadosh Baruch Hu folded the entire land of Israel, which is actually from Iraq, from the Euphrates all the way to the Nile, the Nilus in Egypt. This is really the borders of the lands of Israel, as we see it several times in the Torah, in Bereshit. And Hashem folded it into 4 cubits, meaning that it was 4 amot, the place that Yaakov was sleeping on. Says, this is will be your land for you and your children. But in reality, you know, Kadosh Baruch Hu says to him that V'haya zaracha ke'afar ha'aretz U'faratzta yama v'kedma tzafona v'negba V'nivrechu b'cha kol mishpachot ha'adama v'zaracha. So Hashem says to him, you know, yes, Yaakov, I want you to know your children, and we see it today, will be spread all over the world. You know, what do you mean like the afar ha'aretz U'faratzta yama v'kedma tzafona v'negba? So we know, you know, we are all over the world. Jews are all over the world today. As part of the blessings, when we, Chas v'chalila, don't have the Beit HaMikdash, we don't have the temple, even if there's people in Israel today, Baruch Hashem, we have a nation, we're strong all by, you know, the merit of Hashem and the miracles of Hashem, yet we still are all over exile. Even though that we're in Israel, because of the temple is not built, we are in exile. So Yaakov Avinu is basically, Hashem says to you, wherever you'll be, you'll be blessed. And we see today that Jews are blessing a lot of nations. Everywhere they are, they create goods. They create medicine, they create technology. They influence the area with blessings. That's the, you know, Hashem says, basically, no matter where you are, you'll be, v'nivrechu becha mishpachot ha'adama. You know, mishpachot ha'adama is the goyim, is the Gentile. And he says, והנה אנוכי עמך ושמרתיך בכל אשר תלך ושיבותך אל האדמה הזאת כי לא עזבך. Hashem promised Yaakov that I'll be with you everywhere you will be, wherever you'll step in the world. Adama, by the way, that's where Adam came from. Adama, we are made from the Adama, and of course our neshama is from Hashem. And as we say, Hashem promised to him that I will never leave you, and everything that I will keep. Now, Yaakov having these dreams, and of course he's terrified about this dream, in a sense that he sees that the angel going up and not coming down. He goes, the good angel going up and the bad angels of Esav coming down. Vayikatz Yaakov mishnato. So here, this is a very interesting sentence. You know, we know that Yaakov Avinu took 12 stones originally, and he put them around his head. another he wake up ויאמר אכן יש אדוני במקום הזה ואנוכי לא ידעתי. יעקב is like, how horrific it is that I passed this place and not stopped before, and this is the holiest of places. This is, by the way, there is two opening to Gan Eden, to heaven. There are two opening in the world. One is Jerusalem, which is what we call today Temple Mount. That's where Bet HaMikdash was and will build again Be'ezrat Hashem, or come down ready from the heavens, as the Zohar explained to us. And the second opening to, you know, Gan Eden, to paradise, in Me'arat HaMachpelah. Me'arat HaMachpelah is in Hebron. You know, just so you know, the New Testament, which has a lot of mistakes in it, states in chapter 7, verse 15, in Act, they call it an act, it's really an act. In Act 7, chapter 15, it says that Me'arat HaMachpelah is in Nablus, in Shechem. Of course, they mixed between Yosef and our forefathers. And the two openings, as we said, is in Hebron and in Yerushalayim. Yaakov Avinu says, Ma nora lo yadati, aval anochi lo yadati. So he says, what's anochi? Hashem revealed to him a sight that was revealed to Yechezkel ben Buzi. You know, Yechezkel the prophet saw in the book of Ezekiel, if you go to the prophets, the book of the prophets, you'll see that the Yechezkel describes the chariot of Hashem, the Merkava in Hebrew. And Yaakov sees the four wheels of the Merkava, the four forces that carries Hashem's chariot. And it's what Anochi is, the word Elo, you know, Aryeh, Nesher, Kruvim, and Yaakov. Yaakov was one of those wheels. And Yaakov, he says, oh my God, I did not know that. How I was revealed this, that from me now I can see that I will be the one to take this fourth wheel and be part of the chariot of God. Merkavat, Maaseh HaMerkava, the chariot of God, in the book of Yechezkel, it describes in details. Later on, just so you know, it will be three neshamot, the same neshama that will carry this chariot, and will be replaced in each time. So the first time that the fourth wheel was Aleph for Adam, right? Adam HaRishon, the first was the Yaakov, is the Gilgul of Adam. Yaakov Avinu is the reincarnation of Adam. And as we see that later on, after Yaakov will pass, David HaMelech, which also a Gilgul of Adam Yaakov, King David will be the fourth wheel to carry the chariot of God. And by the way, it's good to mention here that Adam originally was supposed to live 1,000 years after the sin. Originally, he was not supposed to die. Remember, Etz HaChaim was already there and was allowed, the tree of life. But because of the sin, Hashem reduced his life to be only 1,000 years. But Adam saw in the prophecy in Ruach HaKodesh that there is a baby that's going to die in the womb of his mother, but he will be the one that helped rebuild the Beit HaMikdash. So he gave 70 years of his life to King David. It's the same reincarnation from Adam, Yaakov, and King David. And Adam passed away when he was 930 years. King David lived for 70 years. And of course, King David has something in common with Yaakov at the same location. You know, here the Torah says, וישכם יעקב בבוקר ויקח את האבן אשר שם מראשותיו. So here we see something amazing. Originally, Yaakov, as we see, he had 12 stones around his head. The Gemara will tell us that there was actually a machloket, how many stones, some say it was three. Evan, you know, is an acronym for Abba, Ben, and Neched. That's why we put stone, a father, a son, and a grandson. We put stone on the burials, right? They say that, you know, if you look at the first four words of the Torah here in the parasha, it says, Vayetze Yaakov mi-Be'er Shava. If you count the letters, there's 15 letters, alluding to the 15 years that Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov lived together and learned Torah 15 hours a day together. And then we see here that Yaakov, all the stones that he put around his head, all of a sudden became one. So he understood now that the people of Israel will be united. Originally, Adam was supposed to have the 12 tribes, then Abraham, then Yitzchak, and only Yaakov was the only one that has no Ishmael, no Esav, no Hevel, no Cain, I'm sorry. None of those extra sons that were dangerous to be combined with the children of Israel. So he had basically the 12 tribes. Yaakov Avinu takes this Evan and he makes a matzeva. This is a memorial stone. By the way, this is the stone until today that in Mount Temple Mount that the Arabs build their so-called mosque around it. You know, mosque is coming from the word mask, right? To hide. You know, to Islam, by the way, Islam in Arabic and in Hebrew means no peace, right? E salam, there is no peace. And mosque is their so-called place of, you know, praying and that. It's always masking something else. Has the samich mem. Islam is also, you know, Samael, which is the Satan. It's the same letters, you know. So here we see that the stone that the Arabs today hiding in the Temple Mount is really the stone that Yaakov Avinu set there. It's called Evan Hashtia. Evan Hashtia, as we know, the water that came out of it, and also Shtia from the word Tashtit, is the foundation of the world. Later on, King David, David HaMelech, would also use it when he dug, you know, when Hashem not allowed David HaMelech to build the temple because he was a man of war. You know, it says Ish Milchamata, but it was, of course, a war of necessity and mitzvah. David HaMelech only protected, and he basically taught us a lot of things about the IDF. We are the only military in the world that has defense in it. We always just defense. You know, we don't like to go to war, but Aba le'orgecha, hashkem le'orgo. Whoever comes to kill you, you should get up early and kill them. That's, by the way, how you fight Yetzer Hara. Yetzer Hara is vayikam, come, you get up late, vayashkem, you get up early. That's what Abraham did. Avraham vayashkem Avraham baboker. Here Yaakov vayashkem Yaakov baboker. But when it comes to Bilam, vayakom Bilam. Bilam is Yetzirah. I wanted to curse Israel. How do we defeat him? We get up early. Before the sun even, you know, get out. That's the best blessing to do. So he says that Yaakov took the stone and put it, vayikra shem amakom ahu bet el v'ulam luz. Sham ha'ir harishona. So by the way, as we said, King David, Hashem did not allow to build the temple. Even though Natan Hanavi, Natan the prophet says, yes, go ahead, do it. But David HaMelech, Hashem came to him and says, no, you're not allowed. Your son will build it. But you can do something for it. David HaMelech dug 1,500 amot. It's 750 meters into the ground to allow for all the blood for the sacrifice to be buried in the ground, and of course the water to wash it. And they say that David HaMelech dug too much, and all of a sudden the water from below started rising up. And Hashem revealed to him through the prophets how to stop this water. He says to him, you say the 15 Tehillim from 100 to 115. The Tehillim, the Psalms 100, chapter 102, 115, each chapter will reduce 100 amot. And then the water went down, and David HaMelech used the stone of Yaakov, Evan Hashtia, to stop the water from gushing out into the world. So here you see that Yaakov Avinu waking up, and he does exactly what he says that Vayikra Shem HaMakom Ahu Bet El, this is the house of Hashem, Ve'ulam Luz. You know, Luz, by the way, is a city that's until there today in Israel, in Yerushalayim, it's still there. We don't see it. It's a hidden place. As we say, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, after the sin of Adam, he hid with the sword the city of Gan Eden, right? The paradise on earth, there is what we call, as we know in Bereshit, Vayasem et Adam et Chava Ishto beGan Eden. HaKadosh Baruch Hu placed them there, and after the sin, he removed them from there and he hid it. Even though it's still there, we don't see it. By the way, Luz is very interesting also. So you know, in our spine, we have 18 bones, you know, 18 units in our spine, which is chi. And there is one addition, little bones called the lus. Lus is a small triangle bone that connects the head to the spine. This is the one, you know, where Tchiyat HaMetim, with the resurrection of the dead, the Gemara will teach us and the Zohar that this lus bone, you can never ever destroy it, and from that you can raise a whole person from the dead. You know, in the Holocaust, you know, the Nazis, Yimach Shemam V'Shem Zichram, they did, after they burned millions of Jews, you know, all together, you know, there were almost 13 million people died, 6 million Jews, and about 7 million Christians and all kinds of other nations, you know. And the Jewish people that was burnt in the, you know, Auschwitz and all those, you know, infernos, there were a group of Chevra Kadisha from Israel and Europe and rabbis that went after the war done, they went through all these incinerators, those fiery places, and collected amongst the ashes those loose bones. You know, those are the bones of, you know, creation in the resurrection. They took them, they say some millions of them are brought back to Israel, and they are buried on the way to Tzfat, on the way to Meron, to Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. There is one burial of Rabbi Yaakov, and next to it, there is hundreds of thousands, some say million of those loose bone that could even in the fire could not be destroyed. Even if you take a hammer and try to break them, will never be destroyed. And they are buried there. It's a big mitzvah whenever you're in Israel to go and say Kaddish there. So it says here that Yaakov is waking up and then he's making a vow, neder. You know, neder is something, a vow that you should never do. Don't ever say, I'm going to make a vow to do something. Because, you know, most likely you'll never ever stand by this vow. Many, many people make vows and don't keep them, make promises they don't stand by. And we know we have in Slichot, in Yom Kippur, and before Rosh Hashanah, we do Hatarat Nedarim. You have, you know, Yirei Shabbat and Yirei Torah, either prefer to have Talmidei Chachamim or rabbis to do Hatarat Nedarim. You have to have also, you know, the people that's standing in front of them, and they have to annul those Nedarim, those, you know, vows. Yaakov here is making a vow. Even though Hashem just promised him in his prophecy, everything that he's about to ask Hashem, what did he say? I'm going to give you, I'm going to take care of you, I'll protect you, I'll bring you back, everything. Yaakov, all of a sudden, ask again. He says, Vaidar Yaakov neder le'mor. You're asking Hashem in a vow. He says, please, Hashem, you know, walk with me and give me the bread to eat and clothes to wear and return me to my parents' home, my, you know, Bet Aviv, Aya Adonai li le'elohim, and be my God. וכל אשר תיתן לי, עשר עשרנו לך. יעקב says, listen, Hashem, protect me, feed me, clothe me, be with me, and whatever you give me, I'll give you 20%. It's a very odd kind of vow. First and foremost, Hashem gives you everything, you know, regardless, right? Many of us have a lot of things we don't deserve, you know. How do we get things? You know, parnasa, you know, or, you know, wealth, or whatever the case may be. You know, sometimes you see that a lot of people are not righteous, yet they're very rich, you know. So we see that there is, the Zohar says that there's two kinds of richness that come to the world. One through the, you know, your ancestry, your father, grandfather, great-grandfather, great-grandmother, mother, you know, all kinds of mitzvot that they did that you deserve him. It says, you know, in the book of Etchanan, in the last three verses of the Parashat Vaetchanan in the book of Deuteronomy, Hashem says, if you keep my mitzvot, I will take care of your family for 1,000 generations. But if you are a wicked person, a rasha, I will give you wealth in this world, and you'll never ever come to the heavens. You'll be in hell for the rest of your life. So we need to be careful and make sure that we earn this, you know, wealth that we have and the parnasa that we have through mitzvot, because those really the one that would count and stay with you forever. So Yaakov Avinu says, I'm going to give you 20. Aser Asrenu Lach. And we know Yaakov Avinu, I'll say it here, when he came back after 36 years, Yaakov Avinu forgot to give and make this vow that he promised. He forgot to give the 10, 20%, and for that he paid heavily. He said the first maaser, aser, is his wife Rachel passes away upon his return in Kiryat Arba. Vatamot alai Rachel, Yaakov says, because of me. And the second tenth was Dinah, his daughter was raped by Shechem ben Hamor. This is the vow. When you make a vow and chas v'chalila don't keep it, bad things could happen. So again, I urge you not to make a vow, and you know, think about it, and you know, do the best. In Hebrew, we have a term that says, "Emor me'at ve'ase arbe," say little but do a lot. You don't have to, you know, make a vow and this. Just do it. You don't have, because otherwise, if you chas v'chalila make a vow and you don't stand by it, things could very bad could happen to you. So I urge you never to make a vow. Just do tzedakah, support, do whatever you want. Don't say you're going to do it and not do it. Just do it and be quiet about it. So it's Vayera v'hine be'er basadeh v'hine sham shlosha ed retzon. Yaakov Avinu, now, just so you know, is leaving, as we said, his father's home and mother's home when he's 63 years old. And what we said, Vayetze Yaakov mi be'er shava, if we take the three words, Yaakov mi be'er shava, is the last letter spelled the word ever. Yaakov went to the yeshiva of Shem and Ever for 14 years. 14 years, the first 14 years that Yaakov left his, you know, it says that Yaakov Avinu went to learn 14 years. The question is asked, why did Yaakov went to learn 14 years? So, you know, when Yitzchak says to him, Akol kol Yaakov, Vehayadaim yedei Esav, right? The voice is the voice of Yaakov, and the hand is Esav. Yaakov, if you take the word Yad, Yad in Hebrew is in Gematria 14, right? Yad, what's Yad? Why we call it Yad? If you look at your fingers, those four fingers here has three parts, right? So that's 12. The thumb has two parts, that's 14. Yaakov learned for 14 years in order to be able to handle Esav and Lavan. Yad, Gematria 14. Yaakov learned 14 years at the yeshiva of Shem and Ever. Shem and Ever, by the way, Shem is the son of Noach. He lived for many, many, many years. From Noach all the way to Yaakov. And even Rivka, when she had her stomach, you know, fighting in her stomach, she went to the same yeshiva, Lishol et Elohim. She went to Shem and Ever, Lidrosh, what's going on with me? Yaakov learned 14 years, and he says here, the Torah says, Vayikatz Yaakov Mishnato. Vayikatz Yaakov Mishnato. Yaakov finishes Mishnah. Mishnato, HaMishnah Shelo. You were learning, which we call the acronym of Even. Even is Avot, Brachot, and Nezikin. He learned the three Masachtot in order to be able to handle Esav and Lavan. You know, there is the Zohar give us a lot of amazing secrets into segulot, into divine successful things that we could do. They say before you do anything, if you have any battle you have to go fight, or you have any court you know, appearance that you have to, and you, if you want to do anything to succeed, you have to learn a Mishnah before it. Yaakov Avinu was heading out now, is leaving a wicked person, Esav, and is going to another wicked person, Lavan. So he learned Even, Avot, Berachot, and Nezikin. Those three Mishnayot, that's why he says, Vayekatz Yaakov Mishnato. He finished with his Mishnah and he went out. And he says that Yaakov Avinu came out of, whenever the Torah says, Vayetze, like with Abraham and Yaakov, when a righteous person leaves the town then loses the glory and the splendor. And when it comes to another town, this other town will be blessed. And we know that Yaakov Avinu, after 14 years, all of a sudden, Yaakov Raglav, Yaakov, remember, this is a walk from Jerusalem to walk to where he's going, to Harana, usually takes 17 days. We know that it happens to Eliezer, the same thing. Yaakov had what we call kfitzat zman, time travel. Vaisa Yaakov et raglav, he flew. His legs was lifted. And he within 3 hours, he was already in Harana. You know, it says on the way, when Yaakov was leaving, Esav sent his son Eliphaz. Eliphaz, by the way, married his sister Timnah. From him will come 6 children. The 6th one will be Amalek. And you know, Eliphaz wanted his Esav, said to his son, go kill him and I'll give you all his wealth because he stole from me the Bechorah, and I'll give you everything that he's supposed to get, all the blessings that he's supposed to get will come to you. So Eliphaz went to his mother Ada and he asked her, Mom, what should I do? And his mother says, you will not succeed. Don't do it, because even your father Esav, which is the strongest man in the world, could not do it. How do you think you can be able to do it? And when Eliphaz reached Yaakov, Yaakov was very smart and he liked Eliphaz. They used to study actually Torah together with Yitzhak, the 3 of them. And Yaakov says to him, you know, we learned from our father Yitzhak, your grandfather, that a poor man is considered a dead man. You know, poor people, they consider in the Gemara a dead person. So Yaakov says, take everything that I have and, you know, tell your father I'm dead. And Eliphaz agreed with him. And the Gemara will teach us that Yaakov Avinu left with nothing, not even clothes on him. And he was hiding in the river. And a horseman came to drink and to give his horse water. And this horseman drowned. And Yaakov Avinu took the clothes of the horseman. He buried him and he took the horse. And as we say, Vaisa Raglav. And in 3 hours he became already at the place of Lavan. So he says here, Vayar v'ine be'er basadeh. Yaakov sees a water well. You know, be'er in Hebrew, as we said before, all our 4 mothers and fathers, you know, as we know, they all met at the be'er. They all have the same meeting place at the be'er. Be'er is what we call Maim, Maim Chayim. It's a place of Torah. Today, many people meet their, you know, significance other in the bar. Bar in English is the same letter as Be'er, right? B-A-R, Be'er. Like today, they meet with alcohol. Back then, they met with holy water. That's why we have a lot of divorces, Chas v'Chalila. It says you never meet anybody at the bar. The person that drinks so much, first and foremost, that's a big avera. Second, is not a person that you can count on, nor a blessed person. Nobody goes to drink all the time. Unless something is wrong with him. So here it says that he sees that Shlosha Edret Son Rovtzim Alea, meaning that there's hundreds and hundreds of cattle, and for each one of them there is a lot of shepherds that will give their flocks water from this be'er, from this water well. And there is a big stone, Ha'even Agdola, the Torah says, Al Pia Be'er. You know, he says that it was a giant stone that it took literally, they says, some, the Gemara says, 12 of them, 12 men took to remove this water, this stone from above the water well. And V'nesfu Shama Kol Ha'adarim, he said, V'galelu Et Ha'even Ma'al Pia Be'er. Many, many of them had to do that. Many of them had to come and take et ha'even azot, they had to legolel ota, they had to push it, almost roll it. They could not even lift it. Why? And it says that, you know, this was the only source of water, sweet water that came out there. And all the flocks of the area came to drink there. And after they gave the flock water, v'eshku et atzon v'eshivu et ha'even al pi ha'be'er limkoma, and they used to cover it all the time. It took a lot of people to remove it. Vayomer lahem, hayadatem et Lavan ben Nachor. Yaakov comes to them. He says, do you know Lavan ben Nachor? And they say, yes, we know him. He's talking about, of course, you know, Lavan. Who's Lavan? He's the brother of Rivka. And he's the father, just so you know, of all the 4 wives of Yaakov. He was the father who came, you know, from 2 daughters came from 1 mother, Leah and Rachel, And he had two pilagshim. He had two other pilegesh, is a concubine. Pilegesh in Hebrew is yesh peleg. There was a divide. Most of those women were just to come and have, you know, children with. There is no connection as a marriage, so to speak. Pilegesh, yesh peleg. And from each pilegesh, from each concubine, he had one zilpa and one bilha. By the way, these are the four mothers of our Bnei Israel, right? Hence, their acronym of Kippat Barzel, right? Iron Dome come from Kippat Barzel. Kippa is Hashem, right? When you walk with the Kippa, people know you're with Hashem. And Barzel, what's Barzel? Is the acronym of the four mothers. Bilha, Rachel, Zilpa, Leah. This is what's really protecting us. Because of the merit of our forefathers and mothers, we are protected everywhere in the world. So it says here that he says, do you know him? They say, yes. He says, he's a... ויאמר להם, השלום לו, ויאמר שלום. All of a sudden he cares for him, and he calls him his brother, and this and that. And they were wondering, who is this guy all of a sudden asking about, you know, Lavan? By the way, Lavan is Lavan Ha'arami, right? Lavan Ha'arami, he's Lavan, if you rearrange the letters, is Naval Haramai. He was a cheat and a scoundrel and a thief. The Torah will teach us later on that he cheated Yaakov Avinu 10,000 times in the 20 years that they were together. But it says, and all of a sudden, Vehine Rachel bito ba'i matzon. Vayomer, hen od hayom gadol lo ayet ha'asefa mikneh ashku et atzon lechu ra'u. You know, Yaakov Avinu now is asking them to go leave the area. He sees Rachel, the daughter of Lavan, coming, and she was a shepherd, just like himself. You know, they say that all our forefathers and mothers, and even the 12 tribes were shepherds. Even David HaMelech was a shepherd. Shepherd was the best profession for all the Jewish people to deal with. At the time, remember, when you're a shepherd, you have plenty of time on your hand to study Torah. You let the flock just roam in the hills, and you can sit down plenty of times and study Torah. Even Moshe Rabbeinu was a shepherd. Yaakov, when his children descended to Egypt, he says to them, don't ever tell them that you're heads of tribes or strong military people. Tell them you are shepherds to the Egyptian, so they don't take you to the military and live in the land of Goshen, which is the land of Israel. Goshen was given to Sarah, is the delta of Egypt, where today we have the entire water of the Nile pour into it. This is the fertile land of Egypt. As we know, the Nile, by the way, comes from one source of water. It's the highest lake in the world. You know, it's called Lake Victoria. Lake Victoria is the highest lake ever in the world that feeds the entire peninsula of Egypt. So that's the Goshen, by the way. That's where it pours into Yam HaTichon in the Mediterranean Sea. That's where Cairo, Alexandria, Pitom, where all the cities that the people of Israel, you know, were before. It's really the land of Israel. So Yaakov Avinu here, it says, Yaakov Avinu sees and he asks him to leave. They said, we cannot leave. We're waiting for other people to come and then remove the stone, the big oven. So we can then give more water, of course, to even Rachel with her cattle. He says, Odenu medaber imam, v'Rachel ba'i matzon, asher l'aviya ki ro'a hi. You know, he says that Rachel is really, when Rachel passed away, she was buried outside of Me'arat HaMachpelah. She was not buried with Yaakov. And they say that when Rachel is crying, she's crying over her children that in exile, that's coming from the Galut. And Hashem says, don't worry. You know, one day you'll see your children. You'll be welcoming all the children of Israel that will come to Yerushalayim and they'll pass by you and you'll be risen from the dead and you'll stand there and you see them coming. Veshavu banim ligvulam. And you don't have to worry. The children will come. And the Torah says here, Vayika asher ra'a Yaakov et Rachel, right? Vayagal et ha'aven ma'al pi ha'be'er. Yaakov did by himself move this giant rock by himself. This is a rock that takes about 20 people. The Gemara says 12 people. There is other machloket says it takes 20 people to move this stone, this one rock. Yaakov Avinu, the Zohar says he moved it like you move a lid of a bottle of wine. So easily he removed it. It was very strong, by the way, Yaakov. And it says here that Yaakov removed the stone. He kisses, first he gives water to the stone, to the cattle of Rachel, Vayishak etatzon, right? Vayishak etzon Lavan achi imo, Vayishak Yaakov v'Rachel, Vayisa et kol. Yaakov Avinu, after he gives water to the animal, by the way, there is halacha, just so you know, we learned this from Rivka. Yaakov learned this from Rivka, by the way. It says when, you know, you drink, you can drink first and then give the animals, like she did with Eliezer. She gave Eliezer, then she gave water to 10 camels. And by the way, each camel drinks 53 gallons, and she gave 530 gallons of water. Imagine that. But when you eat, you have to feed the animal first. And Yaakov taught us this. Va'even laim sukot, Yaakov Avinu was the first pita, you know, first pound of animals. He built them shelters and he fed them before he ate. So here Yaakov Avinu gives water to all the cattle of Rachel, and then he kisses her and he cries. You know, so there are many, many explanations about this. Yaakov Avinu, first and foremost, imagine you just see somebody, you kiss them and cry. That's a very weird and very odd, to say the least. But what Yaakov really, we have to understand who is Rachel. You know, as we say, Lavan had two daughters, and Rivka had two sons. And Rivka and Lavan were sisters and brothers. So they did shiduchim. Leah would go to Esav, and Rachel would go to Yaakov. But Yaakov, when he meets her, he sees the prophecy that she will not be buried with him in Me'arat HaMachpelah, and she will not be the first one to marry him. And he cried. He kissed her and he cried. He kissed her like, you know, when you kiss your cousin, you come, you kiss on the cheek. You know, Israelis like to kiss on the cheek, back and forth. It's a blessing of a greeting. They say that the shepherds of Lavan saw that and like, what's going on? This is a weird guy. He's kissing his, you know, he says Lavan is his brother. He's kissing his daughter. What's going on here? But he was really greeting her and crying over what he saw in the prophecy, that they will not be buried together and he will not marry her first. As we know, Yaakov bought the Bechorah, right? The Bechorah is both, of course, we said the right to be the Bechor of the nations, to do the Torah. The Bechorah is also, he bought the rights to marry Leah. You know, you have to have a kinyan, you have to purchase, you have to pay something to marry your shiduch. And Yaakov saw in the prophecy that he has to marry Leah first. And by the way, that's why it says that Leah, Einea Rakot, Leah used to cry a lot because she did not want to be married to Esav. And of course, Esav had already 34 wives, just so you know. And then Esav goes and married the daughters of Ishmael. You know, two daughters. And one of them, his name is Aholibama. Aholibama, which is the word Obama in it. An Arab from Ishmael. This is Obama here in America. By the way, make no mistake, this is the best spy in the world ever. To be the president of the United States as a Muslim and destroy so much of American military and everything that we see, the chaos today. You know, if you remember, Obama had an interview with Stephanopoulos, George Stephanopoulos, you can Google it. You know, when they ask him about his religion, Obama says, yes, my religion is Islam. I believe in Islam. And, you know, George Stephanopoulos was shocked. And he goes, you mean Christianity? He was correcting him. Make no mistake, Obama is Muslim. And he, as we see today, the chaos in the FBI and the CIA and everything, the government, it took 8 years. It destroys a lot of the infrastructure of America. So make no mistake here, Esav goes and marries, in addition to all the wives that he have and all the women that he raped and everything, he goes to the house of Ishmael and marries two women there. The Zohar says that actually Esav went to the children of Ishmael, says, if you kill my father Yitzchak, and I will kill Yaakov. We merit everything that they have, the entire world. But you know, Yitzchak was very, very wealthy. From Abraham's wealth, as we know, and then Yitzchak's wealth, you know, Abraham gets wealth both from Egypt and from Avimelech. Same thing, Yitzchak got all the inheritance of Abraham, including the land of Israel. And we know that Yitzchak, also with Avimelech, was very, very rich. So Esav going to Ishmael was really to do a deal with him to kill Yitzchak. He didn't want to kill him, his own father. So you ask Ishmael, you kill him, and I'll kill Yaakov, and we get rid of the Jewish people forever. That's why Yaakov says, "Atzileni na miyad achi miyad Esav." Save me from my brother, you know. This is my brother, but he's Esav. Make no mistake. You know, Esav is the Edomites, is Christians. You know, the Christian killed more Jews than anybody else. Christians, you know, in the what we call the, you know, the Crusaders, they killed 11 million Jews. You know, the sign of the Christian is a sword. Sometimes it's upside down, it's a cross. Sometimes it's upside down, it's a sword. It says when a Christian give you a hug, you should be very careful. You know, Christians, God bless them, and we have a lot of good Christian friends and the evangelists that support Israel and a lot of good some. But you know, in history, it can teach us they were actually worse than Islam. So we hear today in the Galut, remember, we're still in the Galut. Don't ever think for a second that we are safe. We are safe by miracles of Hashem. And our job, wherever we are in the world, is to collect sparks of Kedusha, to promote and bless the places that we are. Wherever Jews are, there is success. Any nation that went against the Jews always lost. Any nations, the history of the world. So it says here, Ve Yagad Yaakov leRachel Achi Avia. Yaakov is introducing, says, I'm the brother. He says, what do you mean Achi Avia? Yaakov says here, I'm your father's brother. What Yaakov was hinting to her, he says, listen, I know your father Lavan is a cheat. I know, believe me, I can handle him. I know how to do it. I have a brother, Esav. I grew up in the same kind of environment, so I know how to do both. Both Torah and both Yedei Esav. I can handle both of them. Vayikishmo Lavan et Shma Yaakov. When, you know, Rachel told her father that Yaakov is here, he was so happy. He says, wow, this is the son of Yitzchak. Remember what Yitzchak, what Avraham sent for the Rivka, 10 camels full of everything, or the best of the world. And he gave it all to Rivka and to the parents. Of course, as you remember, he gave the, you know, dry fruit, Magadim. So Lavan, he says, wow, Yaakov is coming here. He's probably more wealthy than Eliezer. But we know Yaakov had nothing with him. He was poor. He says, Vayechabek lo. Yechabek, he hugs and he checks if he has anything hidden on him. He finds nothing. So he says, Vayishak, Vayinashek lo. He kissed him. The Gemara says that he actually put his tongue in his mouth looking for jewels, for diamonds or anything, margaliot. And he says, he cannot find anything. Yaakov is telling him everything that happened to him with Eliphaz, that he stole, he took everything from him, and blah, blah, blah. Ya Lavan, again, is a cheat, remember. So he says to him, Lavan, Ach, Atzmi Uvesariyata, Ach, Gematria 21. He's already alluding to him, you'll be working for me for 20 years, and this is your first year. You know, Yaakov, as we know, worked for Lavan 14 years for the two daughters, plus 6 years with, until he had all, you know, the 11 tribes. You know, Yaakov, Lavan says to you, my brother, but you're gonna, you know, I'll let you live for real, but ask me how much you want me to pay you. Basically, he was hinting to him, you have to pay me to be here. I will host you. And the Torah says, וללבן שתי בנות, שם הגדולה לאה ושם הקטנה, רחל. ועיני לאה רכות, as we say, ורחל יפת תואר ויפת מראה. So the Torah describes here, by the way, they said, Zohar says that both Leah and Rachel were gorgeous. They were twins, beautiful girls. But because of Rachel shiduch, you know, to Yaakov, and Leah shiduch to Esav, Leah used to cry a lot. They say she lost all her eyelashes from crying so much. Because every time she hears about another crimes of her husband to be Esav, she hears everything that he does. You know, they say that Esav used to murder every day, rape every day. And she was crying so much, she did not want to marry him. And Yaakov saw that Ruach HaKodesh, that's why he bought the right to marry her first. But Yaakov says, listen, I don't have money, but I will work for you for 7 years, but I want to marry Rachel Bitcha Ktana. He says, specifically who? I want to marry Rachel, your daughter, the young one. He knew how Lavan is a cheat. He said, maybe Lavan will get another girl named Rachel. And, you know, Yaakov says, no. Your Rachel, your daughter, and the young one. It's very specific. Vayomer Revdecha, I work for you 7 years. Berachel Bitcha Ktana. Vayomer Lavan Tov. Lavan says, it's better I give it to you than to a stranger. Leish Acher. Shvaim Adi. I say, Shvaim Adi, sit with me, basically. And Yaakov worked for 7 years, and it was like days. You know, Yaakov, you know, worked for 7 years. It seems to him like a week, days. You know, it says when you love somebody so much, the time has no relevancy, right? That's why it says fall in love. You're falling. That's what happened with Rivka when she saw Yitzchak. You know, when Yitzchak went lasuach basadeh, and Rivka saw him, she fell off the camel. Vatipol Rivka. She fell in love when she saw him. You know, and it says here that Yaakov worked for 7 years. Vayavo Yaakov elavan. It says hava et ishti. You know, this is a very odd sentence. Yaakov Avinu comes to Lavan and says, give me my wife. First, they were not married yet. And let me have relationship with her, to have children. So, the Zohar explains something amazing. The Zohar says that Yaakov Avinu was so pure, he was like Adam before the sin. You know, before the sin, Adam and Eve were naked. And they never thought of anything. It was not bad. It was, you know, only after the sin, Vayitbosheshu, right? They were shameful of being naked. But Yaakov was so righteous, and he was at the level of Adam HaRishon before the sin. So it says, you know, there's nothing wrong with, you know, this is the first mitzvah of the Torah, Prurvu, bring me my wife, and I'll have children. It says that Yaakov Avinu says to him, Kimal'u Yamai. You know, Yaakov Avinu is now, after he came to Lavan, he was 77 years old. He worked for 7 years. He's 84 years old now. He never ever in his life had any sexual act or anything even remotely close. The Zohar said that he never even had keri b'chalomo. That he was so pure that he's 84 years old. He says, it's time for me to have my children now. He knew there's 12 children. And he thought that it will be Rachel 6 and Leah 6. So we see here that he loved her so much that those 7 years was like days. And he says, give me my wife. Vayasof Lavan et anshei hamakom vayas mishteh. Lavan, here we go, a cheat. He gathered all the people, telling them basically, he says, listen, I'm going to cheat Yaakov. He's been here for 7 years, and look, we are so wealthy, the water, everybody's blessed. You know, every time Yaakov went to the well, the water came and rose to him, just like his mother. When Rivka came to the well, the water rose. When Yaakov came to the well, the water rose. Like Yosef, too, when Yosef in Egypt, and when Yaakov came to Egypt, the Nile rose toward them, you know. So Lavan says to the people of Haran, he says, listen, I want to cheat him so he work for us another 7 years. I'll give him Leah instead of Rachel, but I want you to give me a promise that you're not going to tell. He says, of course not, we're not going to tell. It's a good idea. He says, give me collateral. And he took the entire wealth of these people, and only then he does mishteh, he does a party, right? Basically, he takes everything. He's not paying for the party, they're paying for everything, and he holds all the wealth of Haran. So it says here, so, you know, he brings Leah instead of Rachel. But, you know, Rachel was so righteous that Yaakov knew his father-in-law as a cheat. So he gave Rachel simanim. He gave her signs of what to say in the night of the wedding. Because you know that one day, you know, Lavan is already cheating him all the time through the 7 years. So Yaakov gave her what we call the chinah. Chinah is a, we see in the Sephardim, we do a party before the wedding, when the woman goes to the mikvah, and then we do Chinah. We, you know, Chinah is an acronym of the three simanim, three laws and halachot that Yaakov gave Rachel as a secret code, and it's chala, nida, and hadlakat aner. Is the frashat chala, how to do the mitzvah of, you know, doing a contribution of the challah before you cook it, and then how to do the whole tahara, all the purity of a woman, and how to do the Shabbat candles. This is the chinah, challah, nida, hadlakat haner. Now, Rachel was so righteous that she gave the sign to Leah, her sister, because she was Leah Bechorah. She was older than her. And they say when Yaakov asked, you know, Rachel, you know, thinking that it's Rachel, he doesn't know it's Leah, he asked her for the sign, and Rachel behind spoke the sign in her voice as if it was Leah. And Yaakov had no doubt, and he slept with her that night. And he says, Vayi ba'erev, vayikach et Leah bito, ve'avo eleah. Yaakov slept with her. Vayiten Lavan la et zilpa shifchato, da Leah bito shifcha. He says that, you know, Lavan gave another daughter as will be a help for Leah. Her name was Zilpah. Vayi baboker v'hineh hi Leah. Yaakov wake up in the morning. He says, oh my God, what have you done? This is Leah. That's not who I worked for 7 years. Ma zot asita li? Halo berachel avadeti imcha. Why are you cheating me? Yaakov complained to Lavan. And Lavan has an excuse for him. He says, listen, I don't know how you used to, but here in Haran, we marry our firstborn. And we don't cheat like you cheated Esav. So, you know, we're even now. You know, we don't give the young one before the Bechorah. Bessie is hinting to him, basically, listen, you bought the Bechorah, but, you know, you already bought her. So this is, you need to marry Leah first. We cannot give you the young one, Rachel. So he says, listen, I'll give you Rachel in 7 days, but you have to promise to work another 7 years. And that's exactly what happened. Yaakov Avinu marries when this, after a week, he marries Rachel and works for another 7 years. And the 7 years, Acherot, Yaakov did all that. And since we're running out of time, I will finish with Yaakov Avinu basically. Within the 7 years, has 11 kids. As we know, Leah had 6 boys and 1 girl. And Leah, after having the 3 boys, she said, wow, another one, she called him Yehuda. Yehuda, why? Because she understood that there is 4 mothers now. She knew the prophecy of the 12 tribes. Each one should have 3. And all of a sudden she's having 4. So she called him Yehuda. Why? Because it's the same letters of Hashem, Yud Hei Vav Hei. She was thanking Hashem, but she also hinting to, from Yehuda will come King David. David, you know, the lineage. So she has 6 boys and 1 girl, Dinah. And of course, we know that Zilpah and Bilhah have also children. And Rachel finally has a son named Yosef. You know, Rachel, she sees everything that's happening around. Everybody's having children. All her sisters, half-sisters, having children. And she asks Yaakov to pray for her. And Yaakov is basically says, what am I, God? He was very much hurting her so bad. They said that one of Yaakov's punishment was because of that. And he says that, you know, Rachel, she says that Vayiftach et Rachma, right? Vayiskor Elohim et Rachel, Vayishma Elea Elohim, Vayiftach et Rachma. You know, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, you know, sees all the greatness of Rachel, and he gave her a son that's better than all the children combined, Yosef. As we know, she called him Yosef because he will add to everybody. Yosef was literally the one that saved the whole world. Yosef would be the one that will basically, the entire world was supplied with food by Yosef. When he became the Viceroy of Egypt after the 7 years of famine, he knew how to handle everything and save a whole world. Yaakov, now only after he's having 11 children in 7 years, He asked to leave Lavan. Why? He knew that only Yosef can win Esav. The Zohar says that nobody of the children could have won Esav, only Yosef. When Yosef was born, Yaakov understood that it's time to leave. And after 20 years, Yaakov is leaving. And of course, he leaves and he doesn't tell Lavan, because Lavan, as we know, Yaakov sees that he's not the same anymore. He wants to kill him now. And Yaakov is escaping. He takes all his children, all his wealth, all his, you know, everything. And Rachel, before she leaves, she steals something. Rachel steals from her father et haterafim. Rachel steals idolatry from her father. So the Zohar says, what are those things? Why Rachel stole those? First of all, she did that in hope that her father will make tshuva. Not that he lived with his with her husband Yaakov for 20 years. He should be very much, you know of Hashem. And look at what Yaakov did for everybody. He should maybe make tshuva. So she stole. The Zohar says that those teraphim used to speak. You know, the goyim used to kill the firstborn, Bechor, and chop their head off. And they would put it and let Satan come into it and speak. Those teraphim used to speak. And Rachel, of course, sat on them on her camel, and he was looking for it, Lavan was looking. He says, you stole from me, Yaakov. Says, what are you talking about? I've been with you for 20 years. I mean, did nothing but great things for you. And Yaakov says, whoever stole them should die, not knowing that Rachel has them. That's why when Rachel comes to the land of Israel, Vatamot Rachel alai, as we could see, right after the birth of Binyamin. You know, Binyamin is the only son that was Tzabar, that was born in Israel. Of all the tribes, you know, there's 13 of them, right? Include Levi, that is not counting the tribes, because Levi has no Nachala b'Israel. He doesn't have. The land that he has is the land of the 48 city of shelters and the Beit HaMikdash. And as we know, Binyamin was the only one that never bowed to anybody. Not even to Esav, not even to any of the kings. Binyamin is Ben Yamin, is the right son. And we see that Yaakov Avinu now, he also, on the way out, as Lavan reaches him, Yaakov is basically doing an agreement with Lavan. And it says something amazing here, by the way. In the entire Torah, there is only two words from Aramaic that went into the Torah. And Yaakov Avinu make a deal with Lavan. They build a stone, a matzeva, ve'ata lecha ve'nichreta berit. Let's have a covenant, Yaakov says to Lavan, b'ni u'vencha, so we don't fight each other. But Yaakov takes this stone and make it a matzeva. And he says, Yaakov Avinu, tell Lavan, this will be our covenant. This will be an oath between us. And Lavan called this stone, this matzeva, Yagar Shehiduta. This is the only two words of Aramaic that went into the Torah. And Yagar Shehiduta, what's Yagar? To live. Shehiduta is the Shahidim. This is really Daesh. Lavan is cursing Yaakov with the Arabs in Israel and around it that will be killers. That will be like the Ishmaelites that has Pere Adam. There will be people that, not really people, more worse than animal. It says, Ve'yaakov karalo Galaed. Yaakov called that stone Galaed, the gathering of stone. There will be Ed, it will be a testimony, a witness. And Vayomer Lavan, Hagal hazeh Ed b'ni u'vencha hayom al ken karashmo Galaed. You know, in the Megillah, in the Haggadah of Pesach, we have a term that says Arami Oved Avi Vayered Mitzrayma. So the Zohar explained to us, who is Arami Oved Avi? You know, Arami is Lavan. Lavan is coming a reincarnation of Bilam. Bilam was the grandson of Lavan. And he, the one that wanted to destroy the people of Israel in Egypt. When the Torah says, Kol haben ha-yehora tashlichu, kill all the boys, when the Pharaoh decided to kill all the boys, it was Bilam. He was sent down to Egypt to kill Yaakov, and he fell, so he wanted to kill the children of Israel. So we see here the Yegar Shehuduta, those two Aramaic words that went into the Torah, the entire Torah is in Hebrew, except those two in Aramaic. He says, Chaz v'chalila, when you do a covenant with the Goyim, make sure first and foremost that it's on your term. You know, they say weakness never bring peace. Only strength bring peace. And Yaakov Avinu made this matzeva, and later on we see where the Bilaam and the donkey, when the donkey hit the matzeva, the donkey even hit the stone and said to Bilaam, look, our fathers, you know, your grandfather and Yaakov had a commitment not to hurt each other. What are you doing? So here we see that really, even if you have peace, it's very tough to trust the Goyim, because they have no fear of God. And we see here that Yaakov Avinu then goes, and he goes to a place that's called Machanaim. You know, he sees the angels of Hashem. Vayashkem Lavan Baboker Vaynashek Lelav. Lavan leaves, and Yaakov is going to Yaakov Halach LeDarko. Remember, we has one derech, derech Hashem. Vayefgeu bo Malachei Elohim. The angels of Hashem come again. Malacha v'tzave lecha lishmorcha. Vayomer Yaakov kasher ra'a machane Elohim ze vayikra shemo hamakom ahu Machanaim. Machanaim is actually the name of the location where he saw the angels. So Be'ezat Hashem, I thank you all for being here, and for people online, thank you so much for this opportunity to learn Torah with you. Be'ezat Hashem, this class will be posted on our website on nesatorah.org. And you're all welcome to the Kollel Ahavat Israel here in San Diego. We're here every day 10 to 4 and Friday 10 to 1. We'll be happy to host you. And Be'ezat Hashem, I want to wish you all a wonderful week. And tomorrow night we have a class at the JCC in La Jolla, 7:30. All are welcome. It's sponsored by the Partners in Torah and by Mr. and Mrs. Baruch, Bernie Baruch. Be'ezat Hashem, we'll be happy to host you there. Have a wonderful day and Shavua Tov. Thank you so much.